Please give a round of applause. Thank you.
Bless you. Gwen, do you want to come this way?
Thank you very much. Thank you. I feel like I've been carrying equipment all week long. I think, first of all, I have to say about the choir. I don't get to say this quite often, but we went somewhere yesterday, Wormingford. I can't even pronounce it properly. But we went to Wormingford to the church there, the church, I guess. And it was just amazing. There was about 12, 13 of us that went. It couldn't have been more than that. Yeah, maximum 15. The church was packed with people who had, some people had never been to church before, but they heard that a gospel choir was coming to town, so they came. And it was great. You know, you could see something. They something happened, I don't know. For the choir, certainly, the choir said, a lot of them said, this is the best we've ever done. And I was thinking, yeah, actually, it was. Because God was there. We were there just to serve them. And they received what we had to give. So you saw people dancing, trying to mimic the choir. And you know how we go. But we got them up, and you know, and they were all doing this and that. It was fantastic, and the atmosphere was just great. So I really want to thank God for KCGC, because it is people who just give up their Wednesday evenings, and then they go and they serve their community. So please, if you know anybody in the choir, please just give them, you know, a bit of honor, because they go out and they represent Kingsland so very well. And God just comes and blesses people's lives all over the town. So yeah, praise God for that. I just had to do that little blog. And if you want to join the choir, come on a Wednesday. Okay, I've decided I'm going to do that every time now. Okay, so thank God for the opportunity to speak this morning. And I was, all sorts of things were going through my mind about what to talk about. But I settled on this whole thing about our identity, who we are as kingdom citizens. And I thought, what do we eat? Because I'm a Nigerian, and if anybody watches or lurks or looks at Facebook, you might have noticed that there's a certain battle that's been going on between Nigerians and Ghanaians about jollof rice, right? Jollof rice we eat rice so much, but jollof rice is our staple diet. So the Nigerians believe that, any Nigerians in the house, we believe our jollof rice is the best. Well, the Ghanaians say, nope, you haven't tasted jollof rice until you've had Ghanaian jollof rice. And then as this war started, the Senegalese, I think, also said, well, we have a brand of jollof rice. I went once to Chiquitos, I think it was, somewhere, and they made something that looked like jollof rice. This is not jollof rice. Do you understand what I'm saying? So that's what we eat as Nigerians. So when I go to a party, a Nigerian party, if there's no jollof rice, that's not a Nigerian party, I'm very sorry to say. Or that's the party from a Nigerian who has not been to Nigeria in a long time and doesn't know any Nigerians. Because if you know Nigerians, there's somebody who knows somebody who cooks jollof rice, okay? So as kingdom citizens then, what is our trademark food? What do you eat and where do you eat it from? Because again, as a Nigerian, if I don't cook jollof rice very well, which I think I cook it well, but if I want to have a party, I probably will get a caterer to cook jollof rice for me. So where do we eat from and what do we eat? So I thought I would think around that a little bit this morning. And I remembered that in Genesis, God created this garden called Eden. And it says that he put in that garden all sorts of trees that were good to look at and good for food. So that was what Adam and Eve were nourished on. And including those trees included two particular trees that we know of, the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, and the tree of life. So God says to them, you can eat from anything in here apart from the tree, not of life, but of the knowledge of good and evil. In other words, they could take their sustenance from the tree of life. And when Adam and Eve finally sinned, what God took away was not access to all the other trees, but access to the tree of life. So I think there's something about the tree of life that we lost when sin came into the world, and that we regained when Christ came, because Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. And no man comes to the Father except through me." So Jesus came to give us access to the Father. Eli was singing, says, "Come boldly. Come, you have access to God." Why do we have access to God? Because Jesus has provided access to God. And then I bless you version or Bible Gateway or whoever. I typed tree of life because that's how my thought process started. That what do we eat? Where do we eat from? We eat from the tree of life. So what is the tree of life? So I, you know, went to Bible Gateway, and there are 10 times when you can pick up easily the phrase tree of life. And it's Genesis through to Revelation, really. And I'm going to talk from a handful of them. The first, obviously, being Genesis 2:9. It says, "And out of the ground the Lord made every tree grow that is pleasant to the sight and good for food." Like I said before, the tree of life was in the midst of the garden. It was at the center where they could access it. Right, so then, Jesus says, "I am the way, I am the truth, and I am the life. And you come to the Father through me." So our first meal from the tree of life is Jesus. It's Jesus himself. Jesus said to the disciples, "Eat this bread, it is my body. Drink this cup, it is my blood." And people go, "Eat Jesus?" In fact, the disciples went, "I'm sorry, eat you?" And the Bible says they turned around and they left. But you see, our meal, our first meal, is Jesus himself. And Paul said, and I'm going to read this to you, in Philippians chapter 3, verse 10. Paul said, "My determined purpose is that I may know him." This is how we eat of Jesus. He says that I may progressively, I'm reading from the Amplified Version. This is the Amplified Version. He says that I may know him, that I may progressively become more deeply and intimately acquainted with him, perceiving and recognizing and understanding the wonders of his person more strongly and more clearly. So there are depths to Christ that we partake of as we eat of him. First of all, we perceive him. Oh, he feels like he's in the room. I smell Toyin's perfume. It looks like she's in the room. Ah, there's Toyin. I recognize her. That's another depth of perception. That's another depth of understanding. But even then, when I recognize her, I need to understand Toyin. You need to understand me. Because people know me as the choir leader, but actually, I have a son. And sometimes I operate with the choir as a mom. Do I? I'm also a trainer. Well, I used to be a trainer. I still am a trainer. And sometimes I operate with the choir as a trainer. I train them to sing. All of that is still me. Understanding the wonders of his person means we look at the different facets of Jesus Christ. And you see, the reason why we do that is because it is our nourishment. It is what sustains and maintains us. When people try to define our lives and say, "Your life is this." No, my life is not that. My life is who I see in Christ. My life is who I have eaten this morning when I spent time with him and he revealed the wonders of his person to me. That is who I am. Life will say to you, "Yeah, I know you're a citizen of the kingdom. However, you live in our kingdom. You live in this world. So you must adopt our principles." But if I have eaten from the tree of life that is Jesus Christ, then that is what nourishes me when there is famine around. when I have just lost my job, when they have announced redundancies in my office, when my child comes home and says all sorts of things, when I have eaten of who Jesus is, I know who I am. I know whose I am. And I know who my son belongs to. Praise God. Praise God. So yes, firstly, it is Jesus himself. We have no access to the Father except through Jesus Christ. But when we have Jesus, we have every access to come boldly before the throne of grace because we come in Christ. Amen. Praise God. So then the next thing that is the tree of life, I really like this, is in Proverbs chapter 3, verse 18. I'm just going to go through just a few of these. Proverbs chapter 3, verse 18 talks about wisdom. And it's very interesting that when the devil came to Eve and said this real lie about the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, the thing that Eve thought was, it looks good. All the other trees did that. I read that scripture to you just now. It looks like it tastes good. All the other trees did that. But one thing she thought was it was something to eat so she could be wise. That's why she took of that to eat, because everything else had already qualified. But the devil said, you will know something that you didn't know before. That sounds like wisdom. But you see, if we look at Proverbs 3, chapter 8, 3:18, it says, I'm going to read it from the NKJV, that she is a tree of life to those who take hold of her. Wisdom is a tree of life to those who take hold of her. So wisdom, the wisdom of God, that partaking of God is what gives us wisdom, not when we think we know things. So the thing that Eve thought she wanted to know was not going to make her wise. But when we eat of the tree of life, when we operate in Jesus, then we have wisdom. And wisdom, the Bible says in Proverbs so many times, is the principal thing. It is profitable to direct us. Wisdom really is the mind of God. So you can't get wisdom from what we know. We get wisdom directly from God himself. So when we partake again of Jesus Christ, what we receive is the wisdom of God. And then wherever we go, we walk in the wisdom of God. It's almost like I want to tell this story, and I just pray the Holy Spirit will help me tell this story in a responsible way. So a couple of days ago, my son was home from university, and we were just talking, and Jonathan and I, when we get together, for some reason, all we talk about is we try to outdo each other, and who knows, Jonathan says, Mom, I've been reading this in the Bible, blah, blah, blah. And I go, well, have you heard this? And, oh, I listened to Bill Johnson. Did you? I listened to Keith Moore. So we have this conversation. Our house is very, bizarre like that, because that's what we talk about. Anyway, this particular day, we were talking about what happens when Jesus came to town. Now, what is it that made the difference? Why were people drawn to Jesus Christ? So we started, doing a little competition. It's, mother-son competition. But the end result was, we said, the thing that drew people to Jesus was miracles. So when Jesus came to town, one person was healed. He goes back home and says, he went out like this, came home like that. And people thought, what happened to you? Have you not heard? Jesus is here. And as soon as one miracle happened, read the Bible, all the time, people flocked to Jesus. So that allowed him access into their lives to speak to them. Anyway, so we had this conversation, and then we went shopping. And we were just kind of, meandering through town, going shopping, and then suddenly I stopped to talk to someone, and he said to me, Mom, did you see what just happened? And I thought, I didn't see anything. Has anyone seen Jonathan recently? He's 6'3" or 6'4". So he sees everything from heaven. And I'm here, So I said, Mom, did you see that? I thought, no, I didn't see anything. And he said that somebody slapped someone else. He said, this man just slapped this lady, and I don't know what happened. And then some drama ensued anyway. And We were about to leave, but something of the conversation we had earlier drew Jonathan, not me, drew Jonathan to that situation. So Jonathan looked at it and said, "Mom, there's something not right here. There's something not right here." And I thought, okay, let me just follow his lead. And he went into that situation. And he began to pray under his breath. But he went there and prayed. And that situation went on for about 20 minutes. And Jonathan was there. And I then received the wisdom of God, because that thing became a spectacle. So people were going, you know, they were looking and looking. And I thought, okay, there's something. So I was praying as well, but I was outside and they'd locked the door. So there was no access for people to go in there. And I just thought, I need to play my part here. Because this spectacle will not, and please bear with me because I'm trying to be responsible as I tell you the story. So there will be some gaps, but just hear the you know, what I'm trying to say here. So I thought, Lord, okay, I'm praying here, but people are still watching this thing and they're making it a spectacle, which is not really what God wants. And then as if out of nowhere, these three elderly people just came. So imagine that this is a shop window. There's a shop window here. So everybody's watching and looking in the window going, what's going on? What's going on there? And then these three elderly people just stood, one here, and one here, and just started talking. As though they'd just met in the town center for a chat. But they were not just talking. They were blocking the spectacle so that that thing could calm down. And I just thought, oh, okay. So I was standing like this, and a guy came up to me and said, oh, what's going on in there? I said, oh, you know, somebody's having a fit. So he brought out his phone. And I thought, no, this is not what this is about. So I moved and stood next to them as though I was eavesdropping. But in doing that, the whole thing was blocked off. And that way, that situation was calmed down. But it started with Jonathan hearing something and saying, I'm going into this situation. Because if he hadn't, we would have moved on. It's the tree of life that we eat from that gives us the wisdom and the knowledge to operate in those circumstances. And the boldness, because we have been nourished. So we are not weak. We are not afraid. We are not cowardly, because we have eaten right. And we know that if Jesus was in that situation, Jesus would intervene. So we have the boldness to go because we have eaten from the tree of life. Praise God. The tree of life brings healing to the nations. The Bible says in Revelation that the leaves of the tree of life are for the healing of the nations. That's why Jesus came. He brought healing. When we eat this food, when we nourish ourselves from the tree of life, we become Jesus, because we have eaten of him. And then we become him. And he says that if you abide in me and my word abides in you, one, you will ask what you will. See, Jesus is so good. He doesn't say you go hungry whilst I feed the poor. He doesn't do that. That would be a wicked God. Personally, in my opinion, because if I came to you, and I'm not saying people don't go hungry from time to time, but in character, God will always feed you. Especially when you eat from the tree of life, because the tree of life is really what nourishes your soul. And out of the abundance of your heart, you will bring what you need for your own nourishment. Amen. But having said that, it is for the healing of the nations. It is for me to walk to wherever it is my business takes me, whether it is Woodbridge or it is Suffolk or wherever, or wherever. And I know that the leaves from me, leaves fall to the ground, are for the nourishment and the healing of that town. When I go to my office, I have eaten from the tree of life. And what I carry with me is healing for the nations. Praise God. In Christ is all we need to nourish us, to make us strong. to comfort us, to strengthen us. He says he strengthens us from where it counts, in our inner being, because everything comes out of there. Hallelujah. So this morning, for some of us, we just think, yeah, Toyin, that's all well and good. You talk all this wonderful talk. I don't know what that means. Because I have prayed and prayed and prayed. I have read my Bible. And none of this happens. There's another tree. There's another aspect of the tree of life just for you. Two things, actually. It says, a wholesome tongue is a tree of life. A wholesome tongue, which is a tongue that speaks good, well, speaks actually healing. That's a wholesome tongue. Because the converse part of it, it says perverseness breaks the spirit. Proverbs 13, 12. Perverseness. So if you speak perversely, it crushes the spirit, actually, a different version says. So for those of us who say, I don't know what this is all about, we speak from what we have received. So when we eat a scripture, that scripture has to go into us. We digest it. We think on it. We regurgitate it. So that when our circumstances line up like Goliath, it might even be six Goliaths, so you can't even see anything because you have six Goliaths in front of you. That which you have eaten is what you speak. Until Goliath perishes, you stick with what you have eaten. To start with, it was foreign to me when I first started this. And I still struggle with it from time to time. But I have decided, actually, I do not struggle with it from time to time. Did you hear what I just did there? Because the truth is, I abide in Christ. That is the truth. It really doesn't matter what my circumstances are saying. And I have some hurdles before me. If you know me, you will know that I'm not just the person who does this in front of the choir. I have things I'm dealing with in my life. But the truth is, I am anointed and qualified to do the things that God has said I should do. Because that's the word that God has given me. Praise God. So speak what the word says, not what you see. If you've taken the time to sit down with the word and God has given you something, please guard it. Because the thief comes to do what? Steal. He will steal it at the first opportunity. If he can't steal it, he will try and kill something or the other to get rid of it. If he can't do that, he will destroy something. That's what he comes to do. But what did Jesus say? I came. Same sentence. He didn't finish it by saying the thief comes to steal, kill, and destroy. Well, we just never know. He might succeed. He might not. He did not say that. He said, but I have come that you may have and enjoy life. John 10:10. And have it to the full. My Bible is amplified. In abundance. Till it overflows. So when the thief comes to steal, I stand on the side of Christ and say, Jesus came that I might have life and have it in abundance to the full till it overflows. And I say that 500 times until I believe it. Because if I don't believe it, you can't do my push-ups for me. I have tried to get people to go to the gym on my behalf. Nobody can do that for me. I have to believe it for myself. Bless God. So say the word. And then say it again. And then the enemy will say, I'm sorry, what are you saying? You're such a liar. No, you may think I'm a liar, but this is what God told me. This is what my Bible says. Until it changes. And I promise you, God is ever faithful. You eat of the tree of life, he will nourish you. He has a goal. He has a plan. He has his own plan. So he will nourish you so you can fulfill his plan. praise God. I could be here till next week saying this, but I can't because I'm going to Newcastle tomorrow. But God loves every one of us so much. And he wants us to eat and drink from him. He wants us to eat and drink from him and experience him and know him. Philippians, oh, I love Philippians 3:10. That we might perceive him. And then we might recognize him. And then we might understand him. And not just him, the wonders of his person. More intimately, more clearly, more deeply. Can you see that? It's like you're just weaving and weaving and bobbing in this God who is everything. And he feeds our souls. Glory to God. So Father, I just want to praise you right now because we are all here. Yet we are in different places. We are located in different places. But you know, the great thing about you, Father, is that you know where we are. Even though bodily we are seated here, some people's minds are in the hospital. Some people's minds are thinking, dreading what's going to happen to this situation or that situation. Some people are here just, you know, because they have nowhere else to go. Because they want to be able to spend time with somebody, hear somebody's different voice today. You know where we all are. But you are central to everything that we are. So Jesus, we want to eat of you. We want to eat from you. We want to know you. We want to perceive you. We want to understand you. We want to just experience you in a way that is so personal to us that our circumstances cannot withstand what we have seen and known in you. So Holy Spirit, we ask you to just unveil this thing to us, what it means to eat of you, what it means to nourish ourselves in you, what it means to be nourished as a Christian, what it means to operate in the wisdom of God, what it means to speak with a wholesome tongue, what all these things mean to us, so we can go and be you. So we can bring Jesus to town. So we can see from our vantage point that is in the heavenlies. Look at what is going on and insert Christ. So we can insert a word. We can insert healing. We can lay hands on the sick. We can do all the things that Jesus did. So that the tree of life may be planted everywhere we go. We pray this, Lord, because we know it is what you want to do. Lord, I just feel that if there's anyone here who has been longing for the gift of the Spirit to be able to pray in tongues, because this is part of this experience, I ask for that gift to be released right now. It has been released, actually. I just ask for us to capture it and operate in it, because you have given us everything we need for life and godliness. You have given it to us, Lord. So for anyone who desires to be able to speak in the language of the Spirit, to experience the things of the Spirit, I just ask right now for that to just drop into their lives. Let the hearts be open. Let the understanding come. Let the wisdom on how to operate in this come, Lord, so we might walk in the fullness of who you are. We love you. We love you. We love you so very much, oh God. We love you. We love you. We love you because you first loved us. Come on, actually, could we stand and just begin to worship God? Because God has released some things right now, and I just want us to worship God. Eli, let's just worship God and really just express our love for him. Just express your love for him. Just express your love for him. And you know you can only love him because he first loved you. So, Father, we say how much we love you. We say how much we adore you. We say how grateful we are, oh God, that you are our Father. We say how much we love and worship you for Jesus. We say we love you, oh God, for your greatness and your goodness and your faithfulness and your nature, your character. We love you. You, our God, we love you. We worship you. We worship you. We lift our hearts to you and just say, there is no God like you. No one deserves worship but you. So we worship you. We worship you. We worship you. We call you the Almighty God, one and only God, one and only true God, God of all wonders. We worship you. We worship you, Lord. We worship you, Lord. We worship you. We worship you. Oh, Lord, we worship you. We worship you. Oh, we worship you, Lord. Oh, halabakusehe. We worship you and you alone. You alone. Because as we eat from you, Lord God, and you nourish us, worship just flows from us. Worship has to flow. Because it is part of our nourishment, oh God. It is part of what we receive, is the ability, the understanding to worship you in those situations where nothing else can tear it down. It is worshiping God. So we worship you. We worship you. We worship you, oh God. Jesus. How we love you. How we love you, oh God. Oh. Oh. Let it be. just want to leave you with a scripture. With everything I have said this morning, know from Philippians 2:13 that it is not in your own strength, for it is God who is all the while effectually at work in you, energizing and creating in you the power and desire both to will and to work for his good pleasure and his satisfaction and his delight. So God is at work. Amen. Praise God.
Father, I just want to thank you that the tree of life is always full. It's never empty. We can always reach for it and take from it and eat from it. So I pray, Father, for all of us this morning that we will just continue to nourish on you. We get fat from you, Lord, because we're just so full of you. You know, we're just so full of you. It's a good, healthy fatness, Father God, because we're so full of Jesus. So, Father God, I pray, Lord, that we'll just keep on feasting upon you, Father God. That the more we feast on you, the more people will see so much of us, of you in us, Jesus. So, Father God, we thank you. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, I pray, Lord, it'll be our desire to be more like you. It'll be a desire for us to feed on your word, Father God. To receive the truths about your word in our lives, Father God. So I pray that for everyone this morning, that we will just keep on nourishing on you, Father God. Amen. Amen. I'm just going to hang around for anyone else to be prayed for this morning. If that's something that Toya said to you, especially about the gifting of the tongues, I just want to pray that into you as well this morning. Just, yeah. Thank you. Bless you. Amen.